Welcome to the Middleton Cross Plains Area Board of Education meeting for Monday, October 9th of 2023. For those of you joining us in person or from home, we thank you for being part of this very important work on behalf of our students, our staff, and our community. We have turned the page to October, and just like that, the first month of school is in the books. I hope it was a good one for you. I'll call the meeting to order at this time. Those in attendance tonight are Superintendent Dana Minogue, Deputy Superintendent Sherry Syra, Assistant Superintendent for Teaching and Learning, Sylvia Romero Johnson, Assistant Superintendent for Business Operations, Jared Rosing. And our board members present tonight are Todd Berry and Marnie Ginsburg and Bob Green, Tabitha Hansen, Bob Hesselbein, Catherine Kells, Simranjeet Sirha, Gail Shepler, and I am Sheila Hibner. Our first order of business tonight will be the approval of minutes from the September 26th regular meeting. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
A second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And that motion passes. Citizens have the opportunity to communicate with the board on items of interest to them. Please keep your comments to 3 minutes, state your name, your address, and your connection to the district. Please know that the board does not respond to your comments publicly at this time, even though we are listening and we are interested. We have 2 public comments this evening. The first one, Kelly Nelson, if Kelly will come to the speaker table.
Good evening. My name is Kelly Nelson. I live at 7697 Schiller Court in Verona, and I am a para in the 4K program, which I have been for the past 10 years. I am here to share with you the concerns I have about the equitable and safe education of our students in the 4K program at the Early Learning Center. It is my position that the sheer number of students with IEPs in the classes at the ELC cannot be supported by the current approach. Since before the school year began, it was clearly evident that these classes are overloaded at nearly 50% students with the IEPs. This is not inclusive or equitable to any of the students in the classes, which appears to violate the Board of Education's equity policy, which is, I quote, "Every student is unique and deserves a respectful, inclusive learning environment in which to thrive. We will appropriately prioritize educational equity in our schools, including the intentional allocation of resources and opportunities to meet the specific needs of all students. Equity in education means ensuring that every student gets what they need to be successful," end quote. While I understand that this policy is a goal, we are not meeting this goal. We have never started a year with as many students with needs as we have this year. None of the students in these classes are getting what they need. At no other place in the district will you find as many students with IEPs in one room as you do in this classroom. At no other place in the district is a single staff member responsible for so many students with IEPs. The special education teacher has 13 students on their caseload. The special education students are not able to have their goals met as their teacher has too many students to oversee. The other students are not having their educational needs met as most of the resources in the room are there to service or support the students with IEPs. It is not just about the numbers. It's also about the high level of support that each of these students requires. There are so many one-on-ones that need extra support to meet their needs. Also, having started the year with a ratio of 50% of students with IEPs means that there's no room for growth. In almost all prior years, we started at a lower percentage, knowing that there would be additional students moving into the area, as well as community sites identifying students that they no longer can support. These students are no longer have a place to go, as the classes at the ELC are already overloaded. As a result, they will not receive the services that they need or meet their goals. As per the strategy map, the district, quote, "believes that each and every adult is responsible for interrupting inequitable practices and creating inclusive environments for all," end quote. Therefore, it is the responsibility of all staff and administrators to make sure that all students thrive and are receiving what they need. It also states that, quote, "the responsibility of a learner's success and failure lies with every adult in our system," end quote. The administration and the Board of Education are uniquely positioned and empowered to resolve problems in the area of human resource allocation. Therefore, my proposed solution to this immediate problem is to hire a special education teacher to take over half of the students with the IEPs and to support the classroom. This not only alleviates the caseload of the current special education teacher, but most importantly, provides an equitable education for all the students involved. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you, Kelly. Next up, we have Chris Cody Johnson. I'm just going to ask the back of the room, are we having trouble streaming? Okay, so we'll let me know when we're back up. Okay, sounds good.
Trouble streaming, but we are recording.
We are recording. Got it. Okay.
I don't mind if I'm not streamed. Hi there. I'm Chris Cody Johnson. I live at 7207 Voss Parkway, which is walking distance from here. I'm here as the MEA secretary, though I'm also a teacher and a parent in the district, though my kids graduated. And like any English teacher, I have brought, you know, some type of prop. This is the Orpheum Theater, which you might know from State Street. And I want to take you, even though this is a much older picture than this, to the year 1993, which was my last year in college, where I was a student teacher and also managing the Orpheum Theater. And one of the things that managing the Orpheum Theater taught me was that I relied on people to tell me when things were wrong. I don't know if you've been to that theater. Now it does more musical things, but you know, like the ceiling was falling and sometimes the plumbing wasn't working and there were all sorts of things. It was a huge building. But when people would bring their noticings to me, then I could fix them. So I'm here to talk to you actually about the MEA survey, which is where we ask teachers and staff to bring noticings so we can fix them. This is our third year of this survey, and so I wanted to tell you a couple changes that have happened. We're going to launch the survey next week. We'll have all the information compiled mid-November. But based on dialogue from last year to this year, we have changed the scale. So the questions, and I will email you so you can see the sample of the district engagement questions versus the MEA questions, so you can kind of see the flavor of both surveys. Based on dialogue last year, we had some discussion about how the scale would go. This year, we're going to remove the neutral. So it's you have positive or negative, which does, as a run-through, make it a lot more interesting to take. As a result, we won't be able to compare data to last year. So last year, we made sure we compared the first year and the second year, but since we're revamping it, that won't be the case. We also are going to change it that this is coded. Last year, all the information was compiled by five working teachers hanging out in their living rooms, kitchens, and basements, putting together charts. This year, a far smarter person, a graduate of MCPASD, has coded it all for us. Mm-hmm. And so it will just go into different spreadsheets and into slideshows, so it should be far more consistent in its style guide. So those are the updates on it, and I just wanted to let you know it was launching in case teachers are talking about it. And it's under the idea that we can't know what's going on in such a huge system unless we work together and unless we give people a chance to speak, and the survey is a chance to speak. Thank you for letting me speak today, and hopefully while it wasn't streamed.
Thank you, Chris. Okay, it is now time for board correspondence and communication, and tonight we start on that side. So, Marnie.
I had the pleasure of sitting in on the compensation committee last week, and it was really amazing to see this group of educators that were volunteering their time after their long workday to be there, and they were all, the general consensus was that everybody was really passionate and dedicated to the district, and they were there because they were problem solvers and want to make at work. So it was really great to see that process started and that all of these stakeholders are very engaged and ready to work towards positive solutions.
I and my family attended the homecoming parade, which was a great deal of fun, short and sweet. Sweet for candy and sweet in that it was really fun to see all of the representatives from the various schools. We miss seeing Pope, though. But the other elementaries were all represented in other the bands and the cheerleaders and such. And also I won't say much about it because I'm sure a lot of people have things to talk about the Borden Athletic Complex opening. It was very exciting to be at the grand opening of that, having participated in the groundbreaking, which feels like 15 minutes ago. So it was great fun to participate in that and to hear Mr. Borden's speech, which was very, very moving, and the football team won. So that was fun, too.
Mm-hmm. Catherine.
I also attended the ribbon cutting ceremony, and it's really great because they took lots of pictures, and we installed a TV at Pope, and so now my kids are like, look, Mommy, you're famous, you're on TV, and I'm like, that's adorable. I will definitely echo Gail on Mr. Borden's speech. Was very moving. It was wonderful to see all of the people there to support the people who had given financially, the people who had stakes in it, seeing our leadership teams from our athletics people, our student athletes, all of that. That was really great to see. A couple of other things. I accidentally went to Culver's on a share night, so that was exciting. It happened to be for our, I wanted a curd burger. It was not what it's cracked up to be. but I got to participate in the share night for our cheerleaders, so that was great. And I talked to the leadership team of the cheerleaders, and apparently they were raising funds in order to go to a leadership conference. So I was really excited to hear that our leaders in our athletics departments are not just focusing on athletics, but also on the growth of our students in different areas as well. The last thing is really exciting for my kids because I have a second grader, and second graders get to go to the public library and get their first library card. So I love that our district is partnering with the libraries and building a love of learning and literacy from an early age. So thank you to our district for that, and then just building the connection with our community. So
beautiful. Thank you. Bob?
I'll echo a couple of things other board members brought up, as well as with Mari and yourself. The compensation committee, I thought, got off to a good start. Basically, it was just helping everybody to get on the same page, understand where they're going, what directions they're going to go. There's a lot of heavy lifting that's going to be coming forward. But I, as well, was very impressed by the can-do attitude that we saw there and the fact that there was a lot of enthusiasm based on the fact that they're putting in time, not being compensated for some very important work, but still, you know, an important work. Borden, I enjoyed that as well. One of the things I definitely enjoyed other than the speech was the fact to see some old board members that had attended as well. Diane, Kelly Kelscher, some other board members who were involved, who came. I'm not sure if you invited them or not, but it was very nice to see them there. And then also just kind of see the breadth of the community support for mm-hmm. that particular facility. So job well done on that as well.
Yeah, Bob Hasselbein.
Borden was great. I won't repeat what everybody else has said. I'll just say everything everyone else has said is absolutely spot on. It was a great night. Last week I had the opportunity to guide many, many fifth graders through the Wisconsin Veteran Museum's annual Talking Spirits Tour of Forest Hill Cemetery. This year, there were no Middleton Cross Plains area classes there, which is kind of a surprise. I assume that was because of bus system issues.
Don't know. I have to check
into that. Don't know either. But it's a great learning experience for kids and also kind of makes cemeteries a little less spooky and a little bit more historical.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the only one scared was me.
With those many fifth graders?
Yeah, yeah, that's right. Yeah, as many came in as left as many came in. So
that's good.
We were relieved at that.
Yeah. Simranjeet?
Yeah, I won't repeat what everyone else has said. The football games were great. The ribbon cutting ceremony was great. I'd like to thank Shannon and team. Rebecca's here. And I know that they worked super, super hard to put that together. And always a seamless event. Food was great, everything. Last football game, it was raining, but there were a lot of people in the stands. I was so surprised. I, again, only came just to see the marching band because I was forced to, but it was great. Love our team, love our spirit, but it was raining, and it was really nice to see how many people were still there. That school spirit was definitely very wonderful, and looking forward to the marching band's competition at state. next week. A short season, but I think it was great.
Wonderful. Todd?
Yeah. I had the pleasure this past week to have two meetings on reading proficiency. One I sat in with the internal district curriculum review committee that's working on the new reading curriculum. And the focus of that meeting in part was on reading science, which was quite interesting. And it's from that, it's clear that we have a wide range of training levels, competency levels in terms of reading science. Some teachers clearly know a lot. Others were saying, I really need to know more. And so I think that's a good reminder that with the curriculum review coming, we need to make sure everybody is appropriately trained. I also had a meeting today with Sylvia and Mary Beth and Keith about just general staffing and programming and so forth in literacy efforts. And I'll leave you with one closing thought, which is somebody who is proficient as a third grade reader has four times as much chance of graduating from high school as those that are not proficient. So it's great to see the Sylvia and team working with the internal curriculum review team.
Thank you for participating in that. So I have to agree that I think compensation got off to a great start, and we'll have a report on that. I felt too like the teachers in the room giving of their time all were there for the best collective effort. And I want to thank Jared and Barb for leading that. It was a whole lot of getting everybody caught up as to where we are and how we got here. So I appreciate that. One thing I noticed about the parade, I don't know if it's just where I stood for the homecoming parade, but I was surrounded by teachers. And so it's so nice to see all of those staff members in our district participating in the celebration of homecoming. Like many of you, I thought the grand opening of the Borden Athletic Complex was a wonderful opportunity. We celebrated teamwork and collaboration and perseverance and pride. It was a tribute to the Borden family and all those who made it possible. I know that many of our students, our families, and our community is going to enjoy that complex for many years to come. So job well done to all. The board previous and this board for looking at that opportunity and going with it and for it, and to everybody that's worked hard to bring it to fruition. So it was a great night. Legislative update.
Yeah, so just telling you about two public hearings that took place last week. So on October 4th, the Assembly's Committee on Education held a public hearing on AB 377. And then on the same day, their Committee on Health held a public hearing on SB 447. So AB 337 is legislation which would require student athletes to compete on sports teams that correlate with their birth sex. So that was, that public hearing was held. And on, like I said, on the same day, SB 447, that legislation was also discussed. And that is related to the ready-to-use glycagon rescue therapies in schools. So that's all that really happened.
Thank you, Simranjeet. And now it's time for a report from Superintendent Dana Minogue.
Great. Today we honor Indigenous Peoples Day and recognize the contributions of Indigenous people across the United States. So thank you in joining us in that recognition. Congratulations to our girls tennis team for winning their sectional last week. They're having a wonderful season. Last week was National School Board Week. We did take some time to recognize and honor each of our board members individually on our social media pages. And I also want to express our sincere appreciation for your time, your leadership, and for your support. Appreciations to the large team of appreciations to the large team of educators who are working on the literacy curriculum development and renewal process being facilitated by Sylvia and Mary Beth and Mandy and Keith. These individuals are putting in a lot of time to understand what current research can tell us about effective literacy instruction and how we need to connect to the mandates associated with Wisconsin Act 20. The Middleton High School Theater is going to present their first production of the season, their one-act competition play. It's called The 146-Point Flame, and the performance is on Wednesday, October 18th at 7 p.m., and it'll be in our Black Box Theater, which is a great place to see an intimate performance. Tickets are available online or at the door. I do not recommend you wait to get it at the door. I tried that before, and they are usually sold out. So please join our very talented students at that production. That's my report.
Great. Thank you. In our consent agenda tonight, we have approval of bills payable and approval of the treasurer's report. Looking for a motion to approve these items.
So moved.
A second.
Second.
Is there any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Our consent agenda passes. And tonight we have two items for information and discussion. The first item is the MCPASD Education Foundation update. Our director, Amber Kiggins-Leafheit, will present an update on the foundation work.
Hi, I'm Amber. Thanks for allowing me to speak with you tonight. I'm excited to tell you what we've been up to at the foundation during our last fiscal year. Let's see if we can make this work to go forward. Wow. Last year, we opened a new endowment at the Madison Community Foundation. The Mighty Middleton Endowment will provide scholarships for students forever that are pursuing healthcare occupations. This scholarship was started by Jeff and Tiffany Reich, and this is their passion, and they continue to fundraise for it. Mm. We helped raise funds towards the new stadium complex, and we continue to partner in this effort. Our fundraising is not done. We have a second floor to finish. I know last Friday night was wonderful, but it's just the completion of this first part. We have more to go to get across that finish line. We gave $15,000 to help grow your own so we could get more teachers here in the Middleton Cross Plains Area School District, more teachers of color, and also future teachers groups, so students interested in going into teaching. As you know, that is a real problem. The number of students going into the teaching fields have decreased over the last few years. We've transferred $12,000 to date for band instruments. The band teachers have told us that they're in dire need of rental instruments for students that can't afford to rent instruments. A new flute or a new clarinet are what kids that live in apartments and that have to carry it back and forth, what they usually pick to play, costs $2,000. And the past few referendums, there hasn't been enough to replenish the supplies for band instruments. They have a instrument from 1860, one from 1912. Most of their rental instruments are about 25 years old, and the usual life is only 10 to 15. So this is one of our goals for this year. We're trying to raise up to $50,000 to try to get band instruments in those kids' hands. 40% of students in the district enroll in band, and with 70 different electives, that's pretty impressive. And I'm sure you're aware that if a student participates in at least one activity like that, that they'll have a higher graduation rate, better acceptance to college, and music in particular, better math standardized test scores. The list goes on and on why band is good for students and all extracurriculars. We gave $2,000 to help students be able to go to New York City that couldn't afford to go last year. We didn't do an annual appeal because it would have come right on the heels of our successful Bloom event. We raised $65,000 for our caring closets here in the district, and we didn't feel we could turn right around and ask people for more money. We will do an annual appeal this year. We purchased over $20,000 of personal hygiene supplies. We share this cost with Way Forward Resources. About 100 families were helped. We're holding some money that we had raised during the pandemic for internet access, and we will be using this when the grants run out, so kids at home still have internet access. We were a trustee for the Good Neighbor Festival and raised some money for the arts there. And Meals on Weekends, we partner with the area churches. They packed, actually, I got the final number, 5,723 bags last year for the district students. These are for kids that are food insecure and have nothing else probably to eat on the weekend. And we spent $24,000, and so did the churches. It's an expensive program, but one that we feel is absolutely essential. A couple of years ago, those of you that have been on the board longer remember that you were holding some scholarship money, and many of them weren't being able to be paid out because at CD interest, the way the scholarship was written was you could only pay out the interest, and you know, $23 or something for the year. So we took these scholarships, pooled them, and invested them at the Madison Community Foundation. They'll be there, they're growing. We're able, this year we gave out 57,400 in scholarships and over 90 community scholarships. So that was a really good move for students, and we're really proud to be involved helping with that. Every year we do inspiration grants. Last year we only gave out 4 grants. There weren't as many applications, so we took a look at our process and said, well, asking teachers to write a grant in May when they're trying to finish the year isn't real good timing. Mm-hmm. So we're going to try it again this fall and try to give out some more money for some new ideas. Over time, we've given out $136,000 to teachers for that. As I said, we stepped aside from being a trustee in the Good Neighbor Festival. We're a small but mighty board, but we can't keep doing everything. So we decided to concentrate on what we do and what we do well. We didn't go out to the community asking for any additional room sponsorships last year, since we were helping raise money for the athletic complex. We really didn't feel we could be going at them with too many things that would just confuse the issue. So we did get some plaques up in the high school for those that had already given. Galen Education is a good example. They sponsored one of the learning resource centers. This money is used to do the programs that we do for the district. Mm-hmm. Most of the money that comes in goes right back out to the district, and that's the way it should be. One of our bigger donors, Findorf, has been very generous over time, and when we had asked them during the pandemic when the high school was being built, might they want to do a room sponsorship? They said, sure, and they gave $75,000 over 5 years, and they wanted to help with new curriculum ideas. The first year, they supported the hip-hop curriculum. Last year, the environmental science curriculum, helping restore the prairie. If you go to the cafeteria on the north side of the building, there's a beautiful mural up to recognize their contribution. We had an anonymous donor give us $50,000 to help with the Meals on Weekends, and there is also another beautiful mural up. We had raised $25,000 to help with equity within the schools, and two of the things we did with that was to help get some murals out to promote equity. And these were done in two of the elementary schools, and these were generated by students, so I think that's really cool. And one of our biggest activities during the last year was helping with the stadium complex. And here's a picture taken as it was almost finished. Last Friday night when you were there, I'm sure there was lots of things to notice, but one of the things, if you get a chance to go back over, I'd like to draw your attention to. When you go through the entryway, there's a beautiful Middleton mural. If you look down at the bottom, it says Ideal Builders and Findorf. Ideal and Findorf came together where most construction companies would be competing. They said, no, this is good for Middleton, and two of the alumni that are involved with fundraising are from there. So they helped sponsor that beautiful mural. One community bank was a large donor, as was Lake Ridge. I'm going to take some better pictures, but many of the contractors also either discounted their services or gave a donation. And next to the Tunnel of Excellence, there's a round mural thanking them. And with the lighting, we really can't see the names on the pavers there. But we have the first batch of pavers installed. You can still buy those, and we're really encouraging the community to do that. They're $500 or $1,000. And I know a parent reached out to me and wanted to get one for her daughter for graduation. Now, she was involved in gymnastics, and she said, could I get, you know, a gymnast on the block? Sure enough, the company can even do that. So if you have an idea, please reach out, and we'll try to help you, and we'll get it done. This is the thank you wall where we're thanking donors. And as you can see, many of them are blank, so there's room for all you others that would like to jump in and get on board. We also have pillars of the community, and I don't have a photo of that. But I just wanted to show you how generous our community is. Over the last few years, the solid bars show what our assets were, and the solid line shows the percentage of growth. And as you can see, when the pandemic hit, our community really stepped up and has continued ever since. So this year, what are we going to focus on? Well, we're going to try to keep personal hygiene, meals on weekends, the nest, caring closets, room sponsorships. We're going to try to keep everything going, and I know we can do it. We're going to keep raising money for those band instruments, and along the way, we always have one or two things that pop up, and we'll see if we can help with that. But I just want to thank you all as board members for being so supportive with the foundation and the community. Are there any questions? Of course, I have a little QR code there if anyone either online or here would like to give.
Questions? Yeah, sure. Bob Green.
I'd just like to thank you for your efforts on the band rental instruments. Music has been something that was always important in my family, but also looking for people who are economically disadvantaged or disadvantaged for other reasons. In band, it had always been difficult because the availability of an instrument was difficult to find, and then people would get discouraged. They'd play for a while, didn't have a good instrument, didn't feel like they could compete for a chair, and just kind of dropped off, losing the benefits that music does supply. And I think that's just one of those hidden barriers for many of our students that you're helping to solve, so thank you for that.
Oh, you're welcome. It's a really good cause and very needed.
Mm-hmm. Other questions, board members? I would just like to say, looking at that list, I mean, the gaps that your group closes for our students and families in need is incredible. I can't even imagine what would happen without those resources appointed to those causes, because it's really significant, and I know it takes hard work to raise money and to get it to the right places. So I'm very grateful. I know we all are.
Thank you.
All righty. Thanks, Amber. The second item tonight is an update on the Teacher Compensation Committee. So we have three board members that sit on the Compensation Committee. It's Bob Green, Marnie Ginsburg, and myself. So I think Bob Green is going to get us started with an update.
And first of all, I want to repeat what I said about this particular committee. This one's going to be a lot of heavy lifting, a tremendous amount of heavy lifting in terms of work. And both heavy lifting for administration and heavy lifting for staff who are attending this, and then also a fair amount of heavy lifting, which has already been done by the MEA as well in terms of the numbers that they provided. So that being said, talk just a little bit about how the meeting went. basically, administration talked about, you know, committee norms and things such as that, but started talking about past history, where we had 2014, 2015, where we had a salary schedule. We had a salary schedule in place and what kind of what that looked like. And then we moved over to points and kind of what that looked like and some of the movement from the very nice path that the salary schedule had and very clear and delineated to points, which kind of muddied things up. And then we kind of went away from points to no salary schedule, which just muddied the waters even more. Not blame anywhere, but now we're coming back to the point of saying, okay, now some issues have occurred. There's been some discrepancies in salaries and where we're at. And so how do we clean it up? I haven't got to that point yet, but I'm just going to stop right there and then let Marnie and mm-hmm. Sheila talk about where we're at. I think just a quick summation.
Yeah, Marnie.
I think you summed up a lot of it. I think being relatively new as a board member to sort of the observation process, I appreciated that we gave teachers an opportunity to kind of give them the background and then gave them opportunities to give their feedback at the end through like writing and post-its and then sharing out to the group. And I think a lot of similar feelings came up between different staff members about that they valued the district and also that they were excited to be part of a positive solution.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah, I don't have much more to add. We have additional meetings coming up, and I know that Jared is coming up with multiple solutions in all different kinds of ways for us to look at and figure out and find out how much and how long and how that's all going to work out. So I appreciate all the work that goes into us sort of addressing the compensation challenges. One item for approval tonight. So our district policy says that if we are going to receive any donations over $10,000, they must be approved by the board. And so Glacier Creek, the PTO, the Parent Teacher Organization, raised $10,315 for a second set of swings for the playground. And West Middleton Parent Teacher Organization raised $25,298 for a new playground. So I can't even say how grateful we are to our parent teacher organizations to help bring updated equipment to our schools. It's big chunks that can't normally be found in a school budget, and they go to work very hard to make this happen. So we're grateful to our PTOs. Do I hear a motion to approve those donations? Yes, thank you. In a second.
Second.
Is there any discussion at all? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And that motion passes. The next meeting of the Board of Education will be October 23rd of 2023. That night we will have just a regular board meeting at 7. However, I want to remind board members and staff that at 6 o'clock we will be hosting a listening session for Sunset Ridge Park Northside and the 4K Early Learning Group. So that's an important thing to be able to interact with the board directly for staff and for us to hear directly from staff at 6 o'clock in this building. If anyone has any agenda items that are of interest to you, please forward them to myself or to Superintendent Minogue. We thank you for your participation tonight and your interest. On behalf of the Middleton Cross Plains Area School District, I hope that you have a great week. Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
A second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
And we are adjourned.
Got a shot of my shit. Got a shot.
On my block? I'm 7509.
I don't think you set a record.
The whole meeting trying to figure out where to have the CDs.